So now we need to again turn this into Python. And again, we do this in three steps. So the first step is again, we are creating our IIR filter class. So pretty similar to what I've done in the impulse invariance method. And so the IIR filter class, again, as a Python class. And then as a second one, just calculate the coefficients. Calculate the coefficients. And then three, check the performance. And in this case, we do it as an impulse response. And B as a frequency response. Okay, so the first step here, the IIR filter class. In this case here now, this is a second order filter. We will see later that this is one of the main building blocks of IIR filtering. So a pretty important class to create. So step number one is now our IIR filter class. Remember, this in this case here is now a second order class. So when you remember the class we had for the impulse invariance, this had just one delay step, and so now we need to do it with two delay steps here. And so now we have here our input signal x of n, and then the delayed version feeds back to this. So remember, we call this here this factor minus multiplied by A1, and so now we have a second factor here, and this is here minus multiplied by A2. So just in the same idea, and so now we can do the same at the outputs. Now we have not just a scaling factor, but we need to be more careful. So we have also summation unit here. And so this sum goes into the summation unit here. And so that's now our scaling factor, what we had before. So this one is here now B0. And now we have another factor here after this one delay here. And we call this here now B1. And then in theory, we have also a factor B2 here. But in this case, that's zero, so we can just omit that. But obviously, in a generic second order IIR filter case, we also need to take into account of that. So now remember, when we think of our lengthy transfer function here, so then this was here Z2 minus 1. Divided by, and so we see already this here, this is here our B0 coefficient here, and in the -1, that's our B1 coefficient. So this belongs here, the sign belongs to it. So these are our coefficients here covered. And then as we see here, so that's then 0 multiplied by Z2 -2, and this would be here our B2 coefficient here, and that's zero. So we don't need to take care of that. And then now in the denominator here we have E2 S infinity plus E2 S infinity star, and then this was Z2 minus 1, and so now that one here is our first IIR coefficient. First IIR coefficient, and that one is here our A1. So that's here A1. And then here the second coefficient here, that's then plus E2 two real of S infinity, and then again, and then this is just here Z2 minus 2. And so in this case here, so that's our second IIR coefficient. And that's here then A2. So let's now do all this in Python here as an FIR filter class. And I've already prepared the boring bits here so that you don't need to watch me typing a constructor and putting coefficients in there. So what we need is, we need now obviously our B1 and B0 coefficients. So that's our FIR coefficients, and the A1, A2, these are our IIR coefficients. So these are here in this region, quite trivial. And now we have two buffers here. So for one time step and for the second time step, remember here we have here one time step and another time step here. So this one is called buffer one, and this one here is called buffer two. And so these are now also implemented here in Python. And so now with that we can just define our filter function. And so argument here is just x, our input. And so now we need to create two accumulators here. So we have this summation here. So we have got this one here, and so we call this one here acc input. And so acc input here, we see, so it gets the input, the actual input of the filter, and then these two weighted pathways here. So let's say for us first x of n. So that's now just acc input equals x. And so now what the next step here is that we have here the A1 coefficient with a negative sign from buffer 1, and then from the buffer 2 the negative A2 coefficient. So now you see it makes sense to name the variables like this. So we have self dot buffer 1, and we're multiplying this here with self dot, not buffer 1 but with A1, and then we do the same for the other time step, and we're just renaming this here to A2. So with that we have already the accumulator input sorted. So that's so now what we need to do is we need to calculate our actual output here. And so the output is calculated by taking the accumulator input, multiplying this with B0, then taking the buffer from B1 and B2. So you see B0 is special, and that was essentially our scaling factor. And so acc output equals 2. And so now we have our accumulator input, and then we're multiplying this here with self dot B0. And then the next one here is then self dot buffer 1, and we're multiplying this here now with self dot B1. So you see already there's a simple system behind this here, And we are adding this here up and just renaming this here to buffer to B2. So we said we have got our output sorted. So if we have a look here, so that's our output here, and then this is here just calculated by these values. Okay, so then so the last bit is now just shifting the data through for the next time step, so that we're copying into buffer two the buffer one, and then the buffer one gets our the input accumulator, and then with that we can just return our output to our caller. So that's complaining here. No, it's no longer complaining. Okay, so it's happy with that. And so now we have created our IRR filter here. And so now we need to think of our coefficients. Coefficients. So B0 was 1, and then B1 was minus 1. So that was pretty simple. And then A1 was minus, and then E2 S infinity plus E2 S infinity complex conjugate, and the A2 coefficient was E2 two real part of S infinity. So we just need to put these now into our code. So if I just move that a bit over here, then we're actually able to see them both here. So I've already defined here the frequency, then our S infinity here is defined. And so now we just need to define our coefficients here. B0 is 1, B1 is minus 1. And then we've got here the coefficient A1. So that's minus of numpy exp of si, and then we're adding towards this here the conjugate of si, and then the A2 is just the exponential of 2 times the real part of si. And so then with that we can create our filter f. So f equals then so how is this, what do we call this, an IIR filter? IIR filter. And so we see the argument here is now B0 and B1. So that's B0, B1, and then we want to have A1, and we would like to have A2 here. And with that we have created our filter. So that was step number 2. And so now here we have step number 3. Testing the filter. And so step number A is impulse response. So we do this exactly the same. The same as for the impulse invariance method, but everything is real. It's real valued. So let's see. See if this works. So I've already prepared that from the and stolen the code from the impulse invariants. So let's see here what I've done. So therefore, so here is just what we had before. So I am creating a vector x, putting the sample number 10 to 1 and the rest is 0. That's our output vector. And then I'm running this through this filter here. And so let's see if I start this here. Yeah, so then we see here a nice impulse response. But what we see here is we're getting a complex warning, casting complex values to really discard imaginary part in the filter. So we have somewhere complex numbers, and I suspect it's happening here because this A1 is supposed to be real valued, but it's probably has a tiny complex component. So it's saying just 0j here, it's the A1. So therefore what we need to do is that we need to turn this here into a real valued number properly, and we are definitely allowed to do that. Okay, so let's try this again. And so now we see we don't get any error message here. And we see more or less the same what we've seen with the impulse invariance method. So now let's do 3b. And so 3b was the frequency response. So we know already how this works. So frequency response is just h2 e2 j omega, and then the absolute value, and the omega runs from minus pi to plus pi. So that's the negative Nyquist. And that's here the positive. So essentially what we are interested in is just the positive frequencies. Usually we're just looking at this from 0 to pi to see the frequency response of that. And so the only thing what we need to do is we need to take our h of z. So and so we're just substituting our e2 j omega in it. And so our h of z was this 1 minus z2 minus 1, and then divided by 1 minus e2 s infinity plus e2 s infinity star z2 minus 1. Let's make this here a bit longer, and then here we had plus e2 2 real of s infinity, and then z2 minus 2. And again, as usual here, we stick with t equals 1, just in case somebody's wondering where the t is gone. Yeah, so therefore we're just substituting the e2 j omega into all our z's here. And then just calculating this. And so then the frequency response is just the absolute value of that. So that's just involves a bit of typing here in our function. So we don't need to filter anything here. So we can just get rid of all that. And then just define our response here. So what do we need is we just need our omega here. So we run this from 0 to pi and do this in decent steps, 0.0101 for example. So that's our omega. Then we would like to generate this into a z. So therefore, we need to turn this into our complex phasor, 1j multiplied by omega. So then we have got that. And so now Just the tricky bit is now getting our response out of that here, or we could call this here h, and then this is one minus that star minus one. So that's our numerator here. If we just have a look at this, so I've just covered that, and so now we just need to cover the bottom part here. So let's see if I manage that without creating a syntax error here, which is obviously quite a challenge just by writing this down here. So exp of si, so that's this guy here. So now we need to add of this one here, the complex conjugate of this here, of si, and so all the brackets closed here, and then multiplying this here with z to minus one. Oops, that's the wrong way of writing this. So like that. So then we have the first part here covered with that. So now we need to cover the second part here. So that's then again numpy exp, and then two times the real value of si, and then multiplying that with z to minus two. So then this gives us our response here, and then so with that we are able to plot our response here, lin space. So we need to rejig this here on the x axis. And then here have np ups of h. So that was misspelled. Okay, so here we've got our response, and so we see here getting a nice sharp peak here at normalized frequency 0.1. So that's what we were expecting here, putting this 0.1 in here. So we can have a bit of a play with this. So therefore you see the Q factor of 10. So imagine what's happening if we change the Q factor to 50, for example. Just bring this here a bit down and have a look what's happening. Yeah, so we see here with a Q factor of 50, this becomes much more narrow here. And so we have a much stronger resonance here. That obviously, if we're changing this here, for example, to 0.2, then obviously we see a resonance at a different point at 0.2. So we see this all works, and so our mathematical calculations work, and now we have essentially developed a second order filter with a matched Z transform.